I think we've discussed this information in bits and pieces over the course of these 2 years, two days. And so, and of course, you know, more years before that. So I'll try to be concise and see if, you know, there are other questions. So as a quick reminder, I just put this slide up there. I think almost everybody is aware, but, you know, just in case, there are three pre-qualified vaccines. Two of them are in the stockpile, and so I just wanted to put that up out there. And yesterday I presented information on some of the label, you know, the package insert changes. So I did want to highlight that, you know, Shancol is pre-qualified by WHO for the controlled temperature chain. And I think you heard some discussion yesterday about, you know, the vaccine being used as self-administered strategies and things like that. I also wanted to very quickly just highlight that in 2017, there was actually an extensive review of the data on OCVs that was done by the Strategic Advisory Group of Experts on Immunization, SAGE, and the WHO position paper was revised. So, you know, just about 2 years ago, we have done quite a bit of analyses of, you know, the data on safety, efficacy, field effectiveness, feasibility, you know, acceptability, and all of those things. So all of those recommendations are in the position paper. So I think we've, again, you know, Gavi gave a really nice presentation this morning, so I don't want to repeat any of that stuff. But just as a context for folks to understand, you know, the how the stockpile came to be, I have like a very quick timeline on, you know, the consultation that resulted in, you know, the development of the OCV stockpile for outbreaks and emergencies. Initially with a stock of, you know, 2 million doses with funding from multiple donors, and was exclusively at that point when it started, was managed by the ICG. So when Gavi approved the contribution to the stockpile in 2000 and, you know, during the period of 2014 to 2018, and I also included there that, you know, they started funding the operational cost in 2016. But right around that time in 2014, there was also a decision that was made to transition some of the non-emergency use, or what we called as the non-emergency reserve, for decision making with the OCV working group, the GTFCC OCV working group. And Gavi already mentioned the upcoming transition to include, you know, the preventive vaccination campaign in hotspots, aligning with the roadmap. So. And you know, I want to give credit to Lorenzo for a lot of the slides that I you know took from him. So just, you know, so we can understand that how the stockpile vaccine has been used, really in these three different scenarios. But we'll see that there is, you know, it's really sometimes real hard to distinguish between these different scenarios. So we have the outbreak response, you know, basically to prevent further spread or reduce morbidity, mortality. And, you know, we do have, I mean, there is, again, that sort of emergency, the timers of the essence component there. The humanitarian emergency crisis, where the risk of cholera is high, and so, you know, it may not be there, and you know, but can strike any time. And then this whole non-emergency use and the whole issue of cholera hotspots that we've been discussing for quite some time now. So where we, you know, these the OCV campaigns do have to be a part of the multi-sectoral approach and the national cholera control plans. Again, thanks to Gavi for the slide. We've seen that these are these two mechanisms right now that exist for access to the stockpile, the emergency supply, and the non-emergency use. So again, the ICG mechanism and the decisions from the OCV working group. So I'll just very quickly touch upon how the mechanisms are generally working. So again, primarily from the OCV working group perspective, and if you have additional questions on ICG, we do have ICG members here. So for the emergency stockpile, again, because of the issue of having to get these requests in a timely fashion, and the approval to happen quickly, you know, being managed through the ICG, once the ICG approves in a very, very short time frame. And I think here, you know, the timeline here is approximately 10 days from submission to arrival in country. And we have seen that for some of these latest deployments, that timeline was, you know, really quick. So I think that's a huge, and yeah, I mean, you know, it does really have that impact at the country level when vaccine is needed right away. For non-emergency reserve, the way the process has been working is that the countries have been submitting the request to the GTFCC secretariat. Again, the GTFCC secretariat has done a really nice job of compiling that information, sending it out to the OCV working group members, and the decision, to approve or ask for more information is done by voting among the OCV working group members. Now, of course, the voting excludes members that have a direct conflict. A conflict of interest. If members have helped with the OCV application, have other activities that are happening, in conjunction with that. So once the decision is made, the GTFCC secretariat coordinates that the approval through the manufacturers and vaccines arrive in country. So of course that process takes longer compared with the emergency one. So I've just provided some links here if you want to go and look at how these mechanisms work. And you can see on this side here with the ICG, there is a dashboard that shows how many vaccine requests have been put in, what the decision is. So all of that information is available on the website. For the non-emergency one, all of the information is available on these websites that I indicated. There is a declaration of interest to use cholera vaccine, and most of the countries that have used that right now are probably already aware of this process. So in terms of the criteria, there is that information both for the emergency as well as for the non-emergency use, looking at the risk of cholera, the severity, the wash conditions, capacity to improve those conditions, the capacity to implement OCV campaigns and M&E components. And then again, now that with the national cholera control plans and the linkages with the roadmap are really critical. There has been for the past, couple of years now, and Monica indicated that in her presentation on the OCV, on the WASH Working Group meeting update, that there is, an additional review that looks at, what kind of WASH is being proposed along with these, the OCV requests. So we do have that component included at this point. We've already talked about this. So what I want to highlight here once more, I think we've seen this several times already and highlighted the vaccine availability issue, that as you can see, the blue bars in terms of the requested doses, and the approvals are kind of like trending in that direction. But if you really look at that green bar, it's, that sort of indicates where we stand with the supply at this point. And so as you can see, that sort of, bar there is steady, and so it's really increasing that discrepancy between requested and shipped doses. So I think we've already mentioned that quite a few times here. There have been a few strategies that have been used now to try to see how we can deal with this vaccine supply issue and at the same time use vaccine more efficiently with the highest possible impact that we can have in those conditions. So, with outbreak situations, there have been, the single dose that is being used. We do have studies that have looked at the efficacy of a single dose, as well as some dosing interval studies that have been done. And so it gives us a little bit more flexibility we are able to strategize a little bit better, but it's still not ideal is what I want to communicate here. So this is the information that Lorenzo very nicely put together. What I want to show here is how these vaccines have been used in different settings. But the chart on the left side, what I want to show there is that although there were some of these situations where it was done in an hotspot, you would think it's an endemic situation, less urgent, but a lot of these requests actually came for outbreak situations the hotspot situations or for humanitarian crises were urgent. And so I think that really highlights some of the needs that we've been talking about in terms of having some flexibility, to be able to manage how the vaccines are used. And the figure below, I just want to highlight here that while we try to put them in these different buckets, this is what we see as the reality. Often the endemic, epidemic, and the crisis situation all combines into one. But we've seen a lot of progress. From 2013 to 2019, a lot of countries have used vaccine, and now we have about 22 countries, and this is data as of February. I think it's similar right now, that 22 countries have used OCV. There were four new countries in 2018 that applied and got the vaccine and have now experience using the vaccine. So we do see that increasing confidence. So Adam made a very nice presentation from Gavi. So what I want to highlight here are these opportunities that are coming up. So with the whole Gavi transition and the more sort of focus now going from, in addition to preventive campaigns, also looking at, in addition to the emergencies, also looking at preventive immunization, that's a real opportunity for us to make sure that this is really, the process is defined better so we can meet the country needs in a better fashion. So I talked about this yesterday, so I'm not going to reiterate it, but a lot of discussions happened at the OCV working group meeting, and some key principles were highlighted to make sure that the upcoming cholera program is able to be, have that flexibility and efficiency in the mechanisms that we provide to Gavi, and that discussion is ongoing. Finally, you've seen the slide several times, really highlighting the issue of the national cholera control planning and the commitment, and how do you really demonstrate that impact. I mean, we really want to now see how impactful these strategies can be in preventing and controlling cholera going forward. And so that's it from me.